Swinging axes, swinging picks, convicts toil the years away, shaping stone and baking bricks, build a nation day by day.
Anne! George! Well, how do you like the homestead?
Oh, it's really great, Dad.
Groovy!
Super!
Look at the name over the door. No, Linda. I suppose that's an Aboriginal word.
It probably is, Anne. Your Uncle Ned will know. He's lived around here for years. He'll tell you and George all you want to know about it.
I had no idea the house would be so big. How many rooms?
14, I think.
14, Mother?
Oh, not counting the cellar. There's a very big cellar.
A cellar? Oh, I hope it's haunted.
Yippee! Well, let's go and find out. Well, come along, Anne.
Uh-uh. Not in those clothes. Now, you go and help Uncle Ned and your father with the luggage. I'll go and get dinner.
Well, that was a splendid meal, Mary. You're a great cook.
You'll eat like a horse when you really start working around here.
Well, I certainly will, if I have to ride round many more fences.
Well, you're a farmer now. I never thought I'd live to see my brother give up the sea and go on the land.
Oh, it surprised me too, Ned.
And what about George and Anne? Are you going to like it here, kids?
Sure thing. I've been looking at that old stone place behind the house.
Seen it. Well, there are names and dates carved on the stones. One has a big, broad arrow.
Yes, it was built by convicts around 1820, they say. It was built for the Bannister family. They came out with Philip in the First Fleet. Bannister was an official of some kind, not a convict.
Most of the First Fleeters were convicts, weren't they?
Well, there were some soldiers and a few officials, but mostly they were convicts sent out to be punished for their crimes. They weren't very well educated. Not many of them had a trade. And there was only one farmer.
Was that James Roos, the man who started the first farm?
That was the man. When they first settled here, Sydney was very short of food, and Philip told Roos if he was a farmer to go away and grow something, and he'd get his freedom. Now, that was in 1789, and Roos did as the governor said. He worked very hard at it.
I thought everybody worked very hard in those days.
Well, that's true. Roos worked because he wanted to earn his freedom. Some of the scallywags only worked because soldiers were watching them. That's the kind that built the old dairy.
Well, what about this house, Ned?
Oh, the present house was built later. That old dairy would have been the original farmhouse. All those stones were quarried not far away, hewn into blocks by convicts and dragged over here by bullock teams.
Bullock teams? In those days?
Certainly. Bullocks were brought here from India in 1795. And they soon proved much more useful than horses for hauling loads through the bush.
Must have been really rough, Uncle Ned.
It was a very tough life indeed. Think of quarrying and shaping those stones and lifting them into position on a hot day, wearing heavy convict clothes and leg irons.
Well, the leg irons must have slowed them down.
Well, George, people weren't in a hurry in those days. But they managed to get through some big jobs. You remember that Blaxland, Lawson and Wentworth crossed the Blue Mountains in 1813? Well, Governor Macquarie was so pleased that he ordered a road to be built over the mountains right away.
By convicts, I suppose you're going to say.
Oh, you know it already. The road started at Emu Plains and ended at Bathurst, 101 miles away. It was good enough for Macquarie to drive over it in a coach. Now then, what did you say about slow in the old days?
I take it all back. Or maybe the convicts were lawbreakers, but they must have been pretty good stonebreakers as well.
You're probably right. Of course, hard work in New South Wales must have been a good deal better than life in the dark, cold English prisons. They might have thought they were well off.
Yes, a lot of people seem to think so then, because people who weren't convicts started coming out. And they used to sing quite jolly songs about being bound for Botany Bay.
Convicts free at Botany Bay, like the sun and settle there. Free folk then in London town, ask the right to come and share.
There was a bit of trouble when those free men and the convicts started to mix. Talk about class distinction.
I've read that Governor Macquarie was a great believer in giving a convict a fair go once he had served his sentence.
True. And it got him into plenty of trouble. Being governor, he was open to all kinds of criticism. But he did a lot of good.
And after Macquarie left, W.C. Wentworth carried on the good work, didn't he?
Wentworth believed that New South Wales should not be a convict colony at all. He thought it should have its own government and its own parliament.
Well, he finally brought that about, didn't he?
Yes, in 1855, after trying for something like 30 years.
But New South Wales must have changed a lot in that time.
It changed, all right. Explorers tried to find out what the inland was like, and they discovered new things about it all the time.
Their work must have been terribly dangerous. We know how wild and rugged the bush is, even today.
Oh, hikers are always getting lost just up in the mountains, only a few miles away.
Then you might have some idea of the dangers the explorers faced.
But can explorers tell the time? Look, it's very late and we could go on talking all night. But right now, I'm for bed. Good night, all.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
Say, Anne, I've got a plan for the morning.
Pioneers awake at dawn, crunch the frost to plow a field, brave the floods and fight the fires, harvesting a golden yield.
Oh, we don't often see you up so early, George, especially on Saturday morning. Dressed in those old rags. What on earth are you up to? Oh, here comes Anne. Just look at her.
We're going to explore the old cellar, Mother.
Hello, Mum. Have you got everything, George?
Torches, crowbar, a decent stick in case of snakes.
Snakes?
Or spiders. Oh, come on. I'll go first. Smells musty down here. Oh, can you manage all right, Anne?
I'm fine. Oh, isn't it dark? I can hardly see a thing.
Oh, your eyes will get used to it. Say, look at that old cabin trunk. Well, it looks mysterious.
Like a pirate's treasure. But I'll bet it's empty.
Oh, it's nailed up. Hand me that crowbar.
Oh, be careful, George. Don't scratch yourself.
Here it comes. Ah, that's got it. Shine the torch in here.
Look at this old book. Oh, it's absolutely thick with dust. Wait till I blow it off. What a cloud.
You'll choke us. Oh, it's only on the cover. Now, open it up.
Look, it's all in handwriting. Look how brown the old ink is. Shine the torch on it, George. Ah, that's better. Look, it's a diary of Rose, Alice, Emma Bannister. Quaint writing. Oh, I can't read it in this light.
Oh, you don't have to. We'll take it up into the daylight. Now, let's see what else we can find. Oh, more books and papers.
And some old clothes, too. Well, let me look at them.
Look, we can't unpack it all here. We'll have to get the whole thing upstairs somehow.
Uncle Ned will help us. Let's go and tell them. Mother, look what I found.
Oh, can it wait until we have breakfast? Everybody's famished.
A great idea. You can tell us about it while we eat.
An old diary, old books and papers, some old clothes. Mm-hmm. That's what we've found so far. But we'll have to get the chest up out of the cellar. Will you help us, Uncle Ned?
My word, I will. But I hope it can wait till after breakfast. I'm so hungry.
I know. You could eat a horse.
Well, let's eat fast and get it over. I can hardly wait to see what's in that diary.
And that makes two of us.
Three of us, if you don't mind.
Oh, count us in.
That's for sure.
Oh, we've certainly come to live with history, haven't we? Norman, will you please pass Anne the toast?
Then into that unknown land our explorers bravely stride, climbing mountains, crossing plains, open up the country wide. With swinging picks and swirling pans, men begin the search for gold, spurred by many miners' luck and wealth untold.
Well, Mary, it was your idea to put the diary away until we'd finished our work.
And now we've done it?
Without the help of convict servants, you'll notice.
Yes, we managed very nicely without any convict help.
So what about bringing out the diary?
Fair enough, I'll get it. I shan't be a minute.
Ned, I've been wondering whether the kid should plunder that chest after all. You know, I mean, it really belongs to somebody else.
Not anymore. You bought Nabunga only because the last of the family died. A spinster lady, 85, no relatives.
Uncle Ned, it's very sad to think of an old pioneer family going out.
Oh, God, in one way, but I guess they'll always be alive in a sense, where they've played their part in building the nation.
Well said, George. And we'll soon know more of what they did. Here comes Mary with the book.
Here. You take the diary, Ned. Huh? You can pick out the interesting bits.
Well, that's a tall order. Where should I start? What about this? 2nd of July, 1846. Rose Alice says, "The governor, Sir George Gipps, visited us for a couple of days just to rest. He looks very sick and is going to retire. But there is no doubt that his name will be well remembered. For during his office, a limit was placed upon the use of convict servants."
See, Mother? Nothing lasts forever, does it?
And a jolly good thing, too, Anne. Making convicts work as cheap servants was a very bad business. Mm.
Well, to continue. "And it was decided to send no more convicts to New South Wales. It is now evident that Mr. Wentworth's dream of having our own government will be realized. And it is a great pity that Sir George will not be here when that great day comes."
Hmm.
Well, that's all it says about that. By Jove, this is more interesting. 9th of November, 1848. "Our time has been much occupied, as Sir Charles Fitzroy stayed at Nabunga for a week. And what a week it was. Sir Charles has been very worried about the poor condition of farmlands and crops, and is quite convinced that we'll never produce good crops. But he is quite sure that there are rich minerals in the ground, and mentions that Sir George Gipps told him there is gold here. But he was afraid that should the convicts come to know of gold, there would be a most unruly uprising."
I bet there would have been, too. Imagine all those jailbirds getting wind of real gold to be had for the taking.
Yeah. Well, Papa told Sir Charles that he quite agreed with Sir George, but Sir Charles said that we had not taken any convicts into the country for 8 years, and those who were here would soon be free men. And Sir Charles said the dangers of starvation are far worse than the dangers that might come from finding gold.
Ah, here's Anne. Did you find the scrapbook?
Yes, here it is. Oh, let me look myself. George, just look at this funny picture.
Well, hand it over.
Oh, yes, pass it round, George, so that we can all see.
And let me read the cutting.
Hmm. What a picture. Real old gold fossickers, aren't they?
Now I'll read the latest news from the final extra of 1851. It says, "The idea of getting gold from the ground so fired the imagination that men left their jobs, wives and homes, spent what little money they had on fossickers' tools of trade, and went to the diggings on horseback, or in horse-drawn carts piled high with their chattels, while some pushed wheelbarrows and some carried bundles on their backs." Can you just imagine it?
Well done, Anne. But what about getting back to the diary? Come in, Uncle Ned.
I've been glancing through the pages while Anne was reading. Very rude of me. Apologies, Anne.
Don't mention it. Anything interesting?
Enough to keep us sitting up all night. Perhaps a cup of tea would make a welcome break, eh?
Okay. It's made. I'll pour it. Cakes, anybody?
No more convicts, gold galore. No more guards with lash and gun. Roads and railways everywhere. A new Australia has begun.
You make a good cup of tea, Anne. Very refreshing. But I don't think I'll read through all this.
What is it, Uncle Ned?
Oh, pages and pages about self-government. Rose Alice was really interested. What a great thing Mr. Wentworth did, getting a constitution together and taking it to England so that we would have our own parliament.
Obviously, he didn't join the gold rush.
No. While all that was going on, he was setting the pattern for our future self-government.
What about this? Mr. Wentworth resigned from Parliament to take his constitution to England, and we were all very fearful as to who would fill his seat. It has gone to a Mr. Henry Parkes, an immigrant of whom we know little. Let us hope this is not a dreadful setback to us.
Oh, I say, poor old Sir Henry. Why, he was actually the father of Federation.
Well, Rose Alice was not to know that, was she?
Give the old scrapbook a turn. Here, dated 1883, a cutting describes the opening of a railway between Sydney and Melbourne. The Premier of Victoria was there. His name was James Service.
Service? A very good name for a railway, eh?
And he said at the opening that it was time for Australian colonies to get together as a federation.
Very bright of him.
Well, it was, actually. I mean, after all, each colony, what we now call each state, was being run as a separate country. And that's how we came to get all the different railway gauges.
Well, they didn't stay separate for long. They were soon holding meetings to see if they could form a federation.
Look, here's a newspaper picture of Queen Victoria signing the Constitution of the Commonwealth. 17th of September, 1900.
Well, they didn't waste much time over that. Election in 1899, signed by the Queen in September 1900, and the Commonwealth proclaimed on the 1st of January, 1901.
Right.
According to this scrapbook, it was a real red letter day. A big meeting in Sydney at Centennial Park, a tremendous crowd, and the first Governor-General, Lord Hopetoun, standing up to proclaim the Commonwealth.
Well, let's pretend we were there.
All right, I'll be Governor-General. Hear ye, hear ye. From here on out, the colonies of Australia are a commonwealth.
Yay! And I'll be Prime Minister. My name is Edmund Barton, and I am the first Prime Minister of the new Commonwealth. I've already selected my cabinet.
Oh, and who can I be?
Ladies did not have much to say in public life in those days.
Oh.
Well, you can be Mrs. Prime Minister and come with me to the celebration dinner we're having tonight.
Oh!
What a night that was. Fireworks display on the harbour for the crowds, and the state dinner did itself proud.
This newspaper report says they drank £6,000 worth of champagne that night.
£6,000 worth.
Oh, am I aching head?
Oh, no more champagne.
Well, that's how a convict settlement grew up.
In 112 years, fast work.
For the old days.
So, Nabunga's been part of a convict settlement, part of a colony, part of a commonwealth.
And part of only one family, until now. First the Bannisters, now us.
Yes, well, we seem to have bought more than just a house. I only hope we can live up to the tradition.
You think we can? What do you say, young'uns?
We can, and we will.
No longer colonies are we. Our commonwealth is here to stay. A toast to all our pioneers. We carry on their work today.